Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church in Greenville. It is our delight that you have chosen to worship with us today. Psalm 100 and verse 5 reminds us that the Lord is good, and His loving kindness and His faithfulness never ends. And so it is our prayer today that you join in with us as we worship in song, as we share in the preaching of God's Word, that you hear the Word of God spoken to you, and most of all, that you respond as the Holy Spirit is calling you to. Thank you for being in worship with us today.
Happy Father's Day. It is a beautiful sight to see all these men singing in the choir this morning. We're happy to lead the rest of the congregation in worship. We're going to sing some things about fathers, and we're going to sing some songs about family today. It should be appropriate for everybody, regardless of your gender. We're going to start off with the hymn, Rise Up, O Men of God. Let's stand as we joyfully sing together. Thank you. Thank you, and be seated, please.
Amen. There's no better way than to declare on Father's Day, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What a wonderful way to begin worship this morning. And happy Father's Day to all fathers in our midst today. And what a wonderful time it is to come on this Father's Day and to worship the Lord, our Heavenly Father. And so we are so grateful to be here today. Thank you for joining with us. If you're visiting with us today, I want to say a very special thank you to you, and we would love to know of your presence with us. So if you would please fill out one of those welcome visitor cards there in the pew back in front of you and drop it in the plate as it comes by a little later so that we could connect with you and know how that we might could minister to you and get to know you a little better. This morning I want to share, as we prepare our hearts for worship, from Psalm 24, verses beginning in verse 3 through verse 5, which is a psalm of David, and he begins in verse 3 by saying, "Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, and who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to falsehood, and has not sworn deceitfully, he shall receive a blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation." Would you join me in prayer this morning? Our Father, we come before your throne of mercy and grace, and Lord, we thank you that you are our Heavenly Father. Lord, that you're a good, good Father, and Lord, you never let us down. You never leave us nor forsake us. Lord, you're always there. You're always strong and able. Lord, you're always perfect and righteous. Lord, we want to gather today and, Lord, recognize fathers today, Lord, and thank you for good fathers and those who are in the battle doing the work that you've called us to do. But Lord, we want to thank you most of all for being our Heavenly Father, Lord, and for showing us the way, for being the way, and Lord, all that you are for and to us. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this psalm, which reminds us that, Lord, we need pure hearts. We need clean hands. Lord, we don't give our soul, we don't give our hands to those things which are unholy and unrighteous. Lord, would you give us that conviction today? Lord, would you lead us today as we worship you, that you may be honored and glorified through the songs that we sing, because, Lord, the words come from deep within our hearts. But, Lord, also as we open your holy word, would you speak to us? Holy Spirit, would you encourage us and convict us where we need it? Lord, through it all, may this day bring you honor and glory. May we leave changed because we've met with you. And we ask all of this in your name. Amen.
Hey, Randy, let me go off score here. And I heard a rumor that a certain senior pastor and his wife had twins this week. And there are pictures available on the screen. I want you to see those. Isn't there another one or two? Aw. Yeah. The proud brother and sister. All right. Good. Well, I'm assuming everybody knew that, but I wanted just to take a moment, especially for those who are watching by way of streaming or on TV, but one was 6 pounds and one was 6.5 pounds, right? 6'8" or something like that. And they're both healthy and the mom's doing well, and we're so happy. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Amen. Well, when it comes time to worshiping on Father's Day, there's probably not an attribute of God that is more significant than his faithfulness, because unlike an earthly father, we all fail as fathers, don't we? We fail all the time, but we have a heavenly Father who never fails. He is faithful. He is faithful and true. And we're going to sing an old hymn of the faith called "Faith is the Victory." Let's stand again and sing together. The Let's worship and sing about His faithfulness.
Lord, we come to you today on this Father's Day, Lord, and just, Lord, come to give you thanks and praise you, Lord. Lord, we want to thank you for all the fathers who are here, the fathers who are away, and the fathers who are no longer with us, Lord. Lord, I pray that you'll just, open our hearts and our minds to Brother Matt's message that he has for us today, Lord. Lord, I pray that you'll take these tithes and offerings right now, and just bless them to the firmament of your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Can you say Happy Father's Day? I love you.
Happy Father's Day.
Okay, Margaret, what do you love most about your dad?
Stickers.
You.
I like to cook with my dad.
I like him for really cool things.
I like to have pillow fights with my dad and have walks with my dad.
Daddy always make me some pizza.
Happy
it's Father's Day.
Say I love you.
I love you.
Yep.
I love to fish with my dad.
I like to hunt and work with my dad.
I like to spend time with my dad.
Say Happy Father's Day.
I like to hunt and fish with my dad.
I like to go to the beach with my dad.
I like to hunt and fish with my dad.
Emmy, what do you love most about your dad?
Happy Father's Day. I love you.
Walker, what do you love most about your dad?
Carlos. I love you. Father's Day.
How do you know your dad loves you?
Because he picks me up. Because I'm so smart. Say
your word, you're a good father. I'm so strong.
How do you know your dad loves you?
Because he's kind.
Andy, what do you love most about your dad?
That I love him.
Happy Father's Day.
What is something funny or silly that your dad does?
He makes my brother laugh. He makes us laugh too.
Dad jokes.
Okay, what is something funny or silly that your dad does?
All of his dad jokes.
What is something funny or silly that your dad does?
He sings a lot.
He does.
Happy Father's Day.
What is something funny or silly that your dad does?
Plays with us at bedtime.
Happy Father's Day.
At first, Father's Day, we love
you. I had you with us.
He makes us laugh, and he plays with us.
He kind of tries before he goes.
We go fishing and hunting with him.
Yeah, there you go.
What do you like to do with your dad?
Fish with him, cook with him, take pictures with him, go shopping with him, all that stuff.
I love my daddy because he loves me.
I love my daddy because he kisses me.
I love my daddy because he tickles me.
Our dad is so funny. He is.
Amen. Happy Father's Day. What a wonderful tribute to our Father straight from the mouth of children, and we certainly appreciate that. And let me say thank you for all the prayers and words of encouragement and concern over the last few days. We are home and doing well. Babies and mama are doing well, and so we thank you for those prayers and love and support that you have shown the last few days, and I just so appreciate it so very much. This morning, we're going to finish our series on the family, very appropriately, on Father's Day, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9, as we're going to look today at the way of godly fathers. And as you could tell from the video of our own FBC children up here, godly fathers matter, and fathers matter, good or bad. Fathers matter and make a difference, and that is the way God designed it. And all of this that we've been seeing week to week is that God's plan is God's plan for a purpose, that God knows what he's doing, and when we follow God's plan, things work as they're supposed to. And when we stray from God's plan, we get ourselves in a great big mess. Studies repeatedly over the years have shown this, and specifically speaking about fathers in the home. And I just want to read to you as we begin a few statistics that have proven to be true year after year as it relates to fathers in the home. Fatherless children are 5 times as likely to live in poverty, to repeat a grade, or have emotional problems. 93% of all people who are incarcerated are men, and 85% of them have no father figure. In fact, prison worker Bill Glass has said that of the thousands of prisoners he's met in 25 years of service, not one of them had a genuine love for their father. 50% of children come from broken homes have not seen their father in over a year. 1/3 of all babies born are born to unmarried women. We in the United States lead the world in single-parent families. Statistics could go on and on and on about young boys, teenagers, who find themselves in trouble, come from broken homes, fatherless homes, and the cycles just continue to repeat time after time, all showing us that God knows what He's doing when He says in His Word from the very beginning, when He created Adam and Eve, and He called Adam to be the leader of the home and to set a standard by which his home was to follow and to be the spiritual guide for the home. And this has been God's way from the Old Testament forward. God has not changed on that, even though we are thousands of years removed from the text that we're going to read this morning. God's standard still stays the same, and when we stray from God's standard, we will feel the results of that. This morning we come to Deuteronomy chapter 6, and we need to know that this is a very important text in the life of any Israelite Jewish family. It's called the Shema. You know that. You know that when Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment in all of Scripture, Jesus comes back to Deuteronomy chapter 6, and He says what the words are, we're going to read here. He quotes that to those who ask Him that question. And this Shema is so important because it was given to Jewish families to show the value of the home and the value of spiritual life in the home. I think we could all agree that the home is important. We've been looking at that week after week after week, but kind of where we get the short end of the stick is to say that the spiritual value of our leadership in the home is of priority. We want to provide physically for our home. We want to be supportive in the home. But a lot of times we leave the spiritual leadership and the spiritual guidance up to the church or leave it out altogether. And what we see is that God's foundation begins with fathers and men, grandfathers, and any male influence that would have an impact on the home to hear the Word of God and to be the spiritual lead and spiritual guide so that the home is grounded, protected, and is led by the Word of God. And so we want to answer the question this morning, what is the way of godly fatherhood? Today in 2023, on this Father's Day, how can I be a godly father? Men, how can you be a godly father? How can you be godly grandfathers? If you're not married, how can you one day be a godly father if that's God's plan for you? Men, if you're not married, how can you be a godly influence in the world today? Well, we're going to answer all of that by this single question. What is the way of godly fatherhood? Not only as we look to the fatherhood of God, but as we look at God's instruction directly to us in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And so let's begin and read verses 4 through 9, and then we'll come back and answer that question. He says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates." What is the way of godly fatherhood? First of all, godly fathers live under His lordship. Godly fathers personally, as they walk with the Lord, live under the lordship. And that key word, lordship, I don't want you to take that word for granted, because we're emphasizing the word lordship. Live under the lordship of God.
God. Verse 4 says very clearly as he's writing, and he says, "Hear, O Israel." This is a word of attention, gathering attention, getting Israel's attention, raising their ears to know that what God is about to say matters. It's like if you and I today say, "Listen up, pay attention." That's what God is saying here. And he's saying, "The Lord is our God," making a declaration and then saying, "The Lord is one." He's reminding us that our lordship is to belong only to Yahweh God and his how he works in our life and in the world. We know that this text obviously was written, first of all, to the nation of Israel, which was in the midst of a very polytheistic world, and so all of the nations around them would have had many gods, many visible gods everywhere they turned, and so it was important for God to repeatedly speak to them and say, if you want to live for me, you cannot live like the other people of the world. And can we just make clear today that God still says to his people, to his church, if you want to live for me and be known by me, you cannot live like the people of the world. You can't live like the world lives. This is nothing new. It's always been a part of how God has worked in the world, and God has always called his people out. God is a loving God. God is a gracious God. God's way is for all people to find salvation and to come in to his family. He has provided that way. John 3:16, "For God so loves the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever would believe in him should not perish but shall have eternal life." But in order to have that, you've got to respond to God's narrow way and come in and be set apart, be called out. That's what the church is today. You and I are a part of the church, and we are the called out ones, separate, set apart, not living like the world lives, understanding, making the declaration with Deuteronomy 6:4, "The Lord is our God." We're not going the way of the people around us. In Israel's case, this would be the polytheistic world. We're not going to have many gods who they had existed everywhere and perhaps a god for anything and everything they could imagine. And the world still has this problem today. You know, the world is always facing the same problems. They just take on a new face. America is a polytheistic culture. We may not have gods on shelves like you travel to other nations of the world today, and you will find. I've been in many homes of people of other religions around the world and walking in those homes and seeing gods everywhere, literally statue gods. Now, we know they're not really, they have no power, they have no being, they have no authority. But to them, it is important because they worship them. And there is perhaps a god for anything that they need, and they would pray to that specific god. In America, we're still a polytheistic world because we have lords. We just may not put a face to them. We may not call them Lord, but we live like their Lord. We give them our devotion. We give them our attention. They get more of us than God gets. And God is saying to his people, to Israel, to the church today, if you are going to follow me, if you're going to be blessed by me, listen up. You've got to declare that the Lord is our God. And look what he goes on to say in the end of verse 4. The Lord is one. He's one God. Three persons, but one God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He's not one of those is an ounce less than the other. Completely three and completely one. A distinguishing mark of the nation of Israel and Israelite religion was always that they served one God. Yahweh God, the God of Israel. You often hear, as you read the Old Testament, the God of our father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Then he was known as Creator God. That's how the Israelite people knew him, the God of the fathers, God of the patriarchs. But then, through Moses, when God led the people of Israel out of Exodus, guess who he became then? Not only Creator God, not only God of our fathers, but what did he become? Our Redeemer God. The nation of Israel began to see Yahweh God through the Exodus event as a redeemer, not just God of our forefathers, but our God who has brought us out of Egypt, who led us through the wilderness and led us into the promised land. He became Redeemer God, but no matter how God worked, he was always an individual God, a single God, and a unified God. Even though later as God would work among his people and we come to the New Testament and begin to learn that God works and as three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, it's the Trinity, God is always unified. God is being very direct to his people. He's setting himself apart and he's setting them apart. And that's what God wants from us today. I think before we go any further, we must ask ourselves a very important question. Is God really our Lord? Not something we just say, but is he really our Lord? See, on this Father's Day, as we think about being a man of God, as you think about being a child of God, whoever you are, we cannot be who God wants us to be if we're not submitting to his lordship, that key word, lordship, in our life. A lot of times, I think we come to God and we want him to be our Savior because we all want to go to heaven one day. We want to have that personal relationship with him where we know whatever life brings us, and when the end of life comes, however it comes, that we will be in heaven with God. And we want him to be our Savior. But then when it comes to his lordship day in and day out, we begin to play games with God. Well, God, I can't give that up yet. God, I still want to be in control here. God, you can't have that area of my life. God, mind your own business. Can I tell you today, and men especially, listen up, God is not willing to be our Savior without being our Lord. He's not willing to be our Savior. You can't treat God like a genie on a shelf, just getting out of him whatever you want, whatever you need in the moment. And what makes us think that we will make it to God to stand face to face before God one day and hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," if you never lived as a servant of his on earth? In order to live as a servant, then you've got to have a Lord, and he's got to be your Lord. That means what he says goes. That means his way becomes your way. Godly fathers understand the priority of their devotion and allegiance to God alone. God has to come first. Now, we're fallen, and we make mistakes, and we fail every day at this, at his lordship. But when we sin, when we fail to live with him as our Lord, when we become our own Lord, if you're really a child of God, the Holy Spirit convicts you, because God's not going to let you live under any other lordship than his own and be okay with it. And he convicts us, and our response to that conviction should be humble repentance and submissiveness to his lordship. But there are all kind of traps that can be Lord in our life. Money can be our Lord. Our career can be our Lord. Culture can be our Lord. Building up our own name can be our Lord. Hobbies can be our Lord. Habits can be our Lord. So many things in life. We live in a polytheistic culture. It doesn't look like the other cultures of the world that would say they are religious polytheists. But Satan has blinded us in America as Christians to believe we don't struggle with many gods. Oh, we do. And we must hear the word today that if we're going to be those who walk with God and are blessed with God, then we have to be willing to stand today and make the declaration that the Lord is our God. Nobody else gets that place. Only God. Men, your family need to see you put God first in your life, to grow in the Word, and to grow spiritually, to lead them, to make church a priority in your family life, to serve the Lord together, to not do it for show, but to naturally see you having a strong walk with the Lord and a growing walk with the Lord, a prayer life and a devotion life of hearing God's word and applying it to your life and leading your family by it. And we're going to get there in just a minute. But godly men make sure that God stays number one in your life. And I know, because it's human nature, all of us have areas in our life today where God's not number one. And will we be willing to prayerfully, as we hear God's word, say, "God, show me where you need to come back in the first place in my life." Secondly, godly fathers love with their whole being. love with their whole being. Look at verse 5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. You see, this is verse 5 is the natural response to verse 4, really. If he's your Lord, if he comes first, then it's only natural that you love him with all that you are, with all that you have. When God comes first in life, then the traits of God freely flow through your life. I already said that Jesus, when he was asked, what is the greatest commandment? He quotes verse 5 here, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. This, by the way, is an invitation that God has given us to the highest honor of life. The highest honor of life is to live your life loving God and serving God with all that you are. Do you realize, and I think it would do us well sometimes to stop and think, we get to serve God. We get to love God. Stop seeing it as a duty or a task to be accomplished. Let me go to church today so I can mark it off my list and I can feel good about myself. But I get to. I get to have a relationship with God. I get to walk with him daily. I get to open his word and have his Holy Spirit speak into my life. I get to approach him in prayer. I don't need an intercessor. Jesus is my intercessor. And I get to approach him in prayer and bring whatever is on my heart and mind to him. And have him meet me there and respond to him. That is what the Christian life is. Far too long we've labeled it as some religious duty or religious obligation. And when Jesus walked the earth, the most harsh words he had were not to the sinners on the streets. It was to the religious people who were excluding everybody else. The very ones who had taken this word in Deuteronomy 6 and they had misapplied it to their life. They were misapplying it so that it was an outward show of how good they were instead of really genuinely living it out and making a difference in their own family life and as a result in the world around them. It's not about, our walk with God is not about religious duty. You get to serve the God of the universe. You get to love the Lord with all your heart. And if that sounds like some obligation to you, let's just make it very practical. What if you, men, let's say, what if you go home to your spouse, if you're married, and you bring flowers, and she says, thank you, what is the occasion, and you just say, well, I'm your husband, it's my duty, so here you go. How well would that go over? Not good. But you do it because you love her and you appreciate her and you're thankful that you have that relationship that you get to have. And so often we treat God that way. That is absurd to us that we would act that way in our earthly relationship. But when it's spiritually, we come to God and we come maybe into his presence with a begrudging attitude or a spirit of criticism or complaint. Always looking at what God hasn't done or what God is making us do instead of realizing, I don't deserve to be here. There is not one of us that deserve to have a relationship with God, not one. No one is righteous, not one. Nobody can make it to God on their own. I don't care how good they think they are, how religious they think they are. Nobody can make it to God on their own. No amount of religion, no amount of good works, nothing can be good enough to meet God's standard. But God, John 3:16, the most well-known verse in the Bible, says, God so loved the world that he gave. Not you gave, he gave. There's nothing you can give that can outgive God. It requires God's giving to make you right with him. And so your response then, as you walk with God, as you love God, and as you respond to the love of God, is that I get to love God because he first loved me. And you see, when you begin to look at your relationship with God that way, and you come across scripture and you read things that you really don't want to hear right now because it's convicting you, you realize I better submit to this because God loves me. God has a better plan for me. God wants the best for me. Romans 8. And so I get to have a relationship with God, and I may not understand it all now, but one day I will when I see Him face to face, and none of it will matter anymore. And we need to walk in our daily life every day understanding that we don't have to, we get to. And that changes everything. This is an invitation to the highest honor. He says, love for God, love God with all of your heart. That means you're devoted to only one. Only God can transform the heart. And the heart, above all things, the Bible says, is wicked. Every sin, every wickedness comes out of the heart. The mouth speaks from out of the heart. That's why when somebody says something and you're like, where did that come from? You know what's going on when inside of them. They're showing their true colors. It comes out of the heart. And please, please, please don't fall for the world's lie to just follow your heart. Because your heart's going to lead you straight to hell. Because it's wicked. He transforms our hearts. Love Him with all that you are. Let Him transform you. Don't have divided allegiance in your life. He will not settle for that. With all your soul, the depth of who you are, deep within, and with all your strength, every ounce of being, as strong as we may be and as weak as we may be, we give it all to Him to commit to serve Him. Paul said, it is in my weakness that His strength is made perfect. God will not settle for divided love within the heart, the soul, or the strength, because He's worthy of it all. He wants it all. He's given His all. Why do we give God divided love? May we ask ourselves this morning, how well are we measuring up in how we love God? I know we fall short, we all do. But we need to understand that the most important part of who we are, it's not the name that we're building for ourselves or our career or anything that we've accomplished in life. It all that matters when it comes down to it, when the end of life is over, and life is very short, by the way. We need to all remember that. None of us are promised tomorrow. And even if you live 90 years, that is a short time in the span of all eternity. Life is short. And one day, anything that we could build up in this world will not matter. Just ask King Solomon. You go read the book of Ecclesiastes sometime, and it looks like almost like a mirror to our world today. Where is all the meaning in life? And Solomon had everything at his disposal to get and to try to find meaning. He searched for it literally everywhere he could. Money. And when he got money, he only wanted more. And fame. And when he got fame, he only wanted more. And when he got power, he only wanted more. And everything he got, he just wanted more. And it left him miserable. And then he comes to the end of the book and he says, I found the meaning of life. To love God and keep His commands. Learn from those who've made mistakes before you so you don't make the same mistakes. How well are we loving God with all that we are? Men, does your family know that you have a strong love for God? Because they see it when nobody else is around. You're not one person at church and a different person at home. Because when He's really your Lord, He's transformed you everywhere you go. David said, I've committed to walk with integrity in my own house, the most private place he could have. Lastly, godly fathers lead with a divine focus. Godly fathers lead with a divine focus. Look at verse 6. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. Do you see the natural progression here from verse 4 to verse 5 to verses 6 through 9? It begins by knowing God. Knowing that He is our Lord. Making that commitment. Knowing that He is one and we will give our allegiance to no other. Then that moves to loving God. If you know God and you really know God, People say they know God, but they don't live to love God. Let me tell you something, they don't know God. They may think they do, but to know God is to love God, because there's no way that you can come face to face with a God who is so much the opposite of what we are in his righteousness and his perfection and so far removed from us, yet he knelt down to love us and bring us where he is, and there's no way to humanly see that and not respond in love for that. So to really know God is to love God. That verse 4 leads to verse 5, which leads to verses 6 through 9, to live to serve God, which begins at home, in our own house. So there's a natural progression here. We know God, which leads to loving God, which leads to serving God. This is the foundation of life. And this Shema is written, verses 6 through 9, was written to Israel to give godly parents the instruction of how to lead their home in the ways of God. Long before there were parenting books and Christian parenting books, God gave his people a parenting book. He said, this is how you do it. You want to raise blessed kids. You want to have respectful kids. You want to have obedient kids. You want to have kids that grow up to be pointed to me and how to love me. Then do this. And first and foremost, as I've said earlier, this is given to the fathers, because the fathers were to make sure this happened in the home. And so he says, these words that I am commanding you, fathers, today shall be, first of all, on your heart. It was not up to the temple or the religious leaders to lead the family. It was on the parents, and it's still on the parents. It's not up to the church today. It's on the parents. Church's role is to equip the family, but it's the family's role to lead the family, to lead the children in the ways of God. And so he says it's got to begin on your heart. The words of God were to be impressed upon the heart of fathers and parents. You cannot pass on what is not important to you. And the opposite is, either directly or indirectly, what's important to you will either directly or indirectly be passed on to your children. And so what are we telling our children that's important to us? What are we telling them matters to us? I read something, I think it was this past week, that stopped me in my tracks, and it's so true. And it was this quote to parents: what you tolerate, they will embrace. Simple quote, but listen to it. Either directly or indirectly, as they watch you, because they are watching you, what you tolerate, as they grow older, they will embrace. And that's how cultures change. That's how the world changes. It begins with toleration of one generation, which leads to full-on embrace of the next generation. What you tolerate, they will embrace. And I want to go a step further and say, what you embrace, they will live by. What you're embracing today will be their foundation tomorrow. It will be what they live by. And so, what do they see is important? Do they see the Word of God on our heart? Do they see us living by God's Word and God's standard? Do they see us loving God with all that we are? Do they see us living to serve God and to please God with our life? But also notice verse 7, at the timing and place that this is to happen. He says, you shall teach them diligently to your sons, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. He's saying here that you shall do this anytime and everywhere. There's never an out to passing on the Word of God to your family. Anytime and everywhere. This was to reveal his lordship in every aspect of life. If one is not willing to do this, then Jesus is not Lord. And so he's saying, you shall teach them. Notice he says diligently. That means with focused attention. You don't just contract it out to somebody else to do. You shall teach them diligently with a plan to lead your children. And this is father's responsibility to make sure it happens. Teach them diligently to your sons. This is passing on to the next generation of leadership. And shall talk of them when you sit in your house. Meaning you shall bring your conversations back to the Word of God and center it around God and God's goodness in your life. When you're walking by the way, when you're living life. When you lie down and when you rise up. He says in verse 8, you shall bind them as a sign on your hand and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. Many Jews took this very literally. Verse 8, and they would make what was called phylacteries, and they would hang it on their foreheads and they would wear it, which drew attention to themselves. It had scripture on it. And when Jesus comes to earth and lives his life, he condemns this kind of behavior because they had turned this into a show of religion, into a show of how religious they were, and that was never the intention of Deuteronomy 6:8. It's not about self-honor, but about ingraining the Word of God in everything that is done in every part of life. Ingraining God's Word. It means we live and die by the Word of God. We inform our decisions by the Word of God. We lead by the Word of God. We have the declaration that if God's Word says it, that settles it. If God's Word says it, then that settles it. I don't have to believe it because it's already settled because God has said it. I don't have to like it. But God's Word says it. The point was obedience to the Word of God. James 1:22. It's not the hearer who's blessed, but what? The doer of the Word of God. Doesn't matter how much you know. Doesn't matter how much you can religiously show. It matters how you live it. Are we students of God's Word? Men, are you students of God's Word? What place does His Word have in your life? Are you leading your family by it? Are we honoring the Word in such a way that our homes are founded and grounded upon it? It must determine what comes in and what goes out. The spiritual future of our children and our grandchildren are at stake. Is our home a place where God dwells? That's what he's telling the Israelites here. Let your home be a place where God dwells. These words, they shall be on your heart. You shall teach them. You shall talk of them regularly and often every day. You shall end your day with it. You shall begin your day with it. Verse 9, you shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. Everybody should know, not because of public show, but because of how you live your life, this is a house of the Lord. And I'm not talking about the church house. I'm talking about your house. This is a house where God dwells. And so then it's up to us. The question is, men, are you willing to be such a man? Willing to be such a leader in the home? I want to close with two perhaps well-known verses of Scripture, one from the Old Testament and one from the New Testament. We all know of Joshua. We all know of Joshua 24:15. Joshua was a great leader who heard these words of Moses. He took them to heart. Joshua took God's word to heart when Moses didn't even take God's word to heart. That's why Joshua was allowed to lead the people of Israel into the promised land and Moses was not. And Joshua has the hard task of leading the grumbling Israelites into the promised land, which he does. And then he gives them a review of their history, basically reminding them of who God is, reminding them of the Shema, reminding them, you remember that God is one? Joshua says, you remember, you go back and you remember what Moses wrote to us from the word of the Lord. Remember what God has done for you as he led you out of Egypt, as he led you through the wilderness. And now here we are on the brink of the promised land. You can see it. And this is what he says. If it is disagreeable in your sight to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves today whom you will serve. Whether, here we go with the polytheism in the world, whether the gods, little g, which your fathers served, which were beyond the river that we've crossed, are the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. You see what Joshua's doing here? He's pointing to God's faithfulness and God's goodness. He's saying, are you going to serve the Lord, the true God? Are you going to serve the little g gods who are back beyond the river that we've already left behind us because God has left us beyond the river? He's led us across the river, and they are still back there. Or the gods of the Amorites, that was one of the foreign nations who had many gods, in whose land you are now living. It's no longer the Amorites' land, Israel. It's your land, and it's only your land because God said so. He would bring you here. So are you going to make the foolish decision to still serve the false gods beyond the river or the false gods of the Amorites who our God has already defeated? Or are you going to serve God? He says, I can't make that decision for you, but you need to choose today because we're at a decision point. But I love Joshua because Joshua boldly stood before the millions of Israelites and he says, it's your choice, but for me and my house, what? We're going to serve the Lord. Man, we need Joshuas today. We need Joshuas today who say to the other people in your circles of influence, you can serve the little g gods that the world's serving. That God's already left in the dust. You can live the way of the world. But let me tell you something. Me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Because get this. In the end, he's the only winner. In the end, he's the only winner. So we're going to serve him. Are you willing to be a Joshua today for your family? Second one is from the words of Paul as he closes the very difficult letter of 1 Corinthians to a very worldly church who were having a lot of cultural influence come into their midst. And Paul's having to correct a lot. He's having to lead them in spiritual maturity a lot. And Paul ends by saying this, speaking to the men of the church. Be alert. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. And let all that you do be done in love. I love 1 Corinthians 16, 13, and 14 because Paul just gives us a series of commands here. And that's what we need sometimes as Christians. We don't need opinions. Sometimes we just need God to tell us what to do. And then we need to get busy doing it. Well, let me tell you, this is what God's telling us to do today. Be alert. Know who you are. Know whose you are. Know the world we're living in. Be alert. Be aware. You're in a spiritual battle. As you are, stand firm in the faith. Don't be moved. Be a Joshua. Act like a man, not what the world's definition is, but what God says a man is. Be strong in the strength of the Lord. And then verse 14, everything you do, do it in love. Jesus told his disciples, all the world will know that you belong to me by the love you have for one another. And you see, that's the theme that's kind of grounded everything we've talked about this morning. Back in Deuteronomy, greatest commandment is love. Joshua leading the people to love God. And Paul saying, be strong, stand firm, but everything you do, do it in love because God is love. So I wonder today, where are we in our response to that? Would we be a Joshua today? And I just wonder, first of all, if there's anyone under the sound of my voice that does not know the Lord, does not, maybe you don't come from a good home situation where you did not grow up knowing the love of God, or maybe you had a father in the home who you don't even like to think of God as a father because gives you a bad picture of what a father is, and I'm sorry for that. That happens way too often. But no, God's fatherhood is not defined by any worldly relationships or definitions. And God is a loving, caring, kind, compassionate Heavenly Father who loves all and wants all to come to repentance. But we've got to hear His call in order to come into His family and be His child. We've got to come His way, not our way. And His way is through the blood of His own Son. He loves you that much that He gave that which was most dear to Him so that you could be brought into His family. And if you question your salvation or you know you're not saved, today you just need to respond to the Father's love. And as you are, you come to His love and let Him save you. In a minute, as I close this in prayer, there's no magic prayer that does that for you. All you need to do is just be honest with God and tell Him that you realize you're a sinner and you need a Savior and you realize He's the only true God and He loves you and He saved you and you want to respond to that. Then you need to make it public so that we can lead you in the next steps and because, most importantly, it's a biblical command that we're not ashamed of our faith. Maybe you're here today and you are a child of God and you just realize there's some things you need to get in order so that God is number one. And let's just have a time where we respond to that. Or maybe men, today on this Father's Day, you would be a Joshua and maybe you would just make a commitment today that you've maybe need to make. Whether it's a commitment you've already been living and you pray for greater strength in that commitment, or whether it's a commitment to start afresh today, the grace of God is here. And it was wonderful seeing our choir filled with men leading us in worship this morning. It's a wonderful sight. And I wonder if we could close our service with our men just kneeling at this altar and just praying for your home. Praying for the next generation. Praying for your church. Praying for your own heart and life. To make a commitment of Joshua and say, it's for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And it's going to start on my knees this morning because that's where I find His strength. I don't know how the Lord is leading each of us to respond, but I know we're at a time and place where we come to a commitment. And are you willing to wholeheartedly, whatever it is, commit to the Lord? Father, thank you for being our Heavenly Father. Thank you for being good. Thank you for being loving and compassionate, full of grace and mercy, leading us in truth. And Lord, I pray today that we would take your words to heart. We would take seriously who we are and who you've called us to be and our role to put you first and to follow you wholeheartedly. Lord, forgive us where we failed. Lead us as we seek to keep our eyes on you and get it right. And Lord, may we make a commitment to this day like Joshua and saying, I can't control what somebody else does, but I can control what happens in my house. And today I'm saying we're going to live for the Lord. Lord, would you just lead us as we respond? And we ask all of this in your most holy name. Amen.
I pray that God has spoken to your heart this morning as we've spent time in worship together. If the Lord has laid a specific decision on your heart, please notice the contact information there on your screen. Reach out to us, whether it's a first-time decision to follow Christ, a prayer request you have, or some other need in life. We are here to minister to you. Thank you again for being with us today, and we hope that you'll join us again next week.